Very dense, very hot region that may have been much smaller than the period on this page. And that's called the Big Bang. Now, the Big Bang began with a Belgian astronomer called George Edward Lemaître, who died in 1966. And according to Isaac Asimov, some of you may have heard of him from his very good books on science fiction, but he was also quite a prominent scientist, Lemaître conceived this mass to be no more than a few light years in diameter. At the very least, that would be two light years, or about 12 trillion miles. So I'm sure you appreciate that George Edward Lemaître conceived that everything evolved from something that was 12 trillion miles across, which was big. By 1965, that figure was reduced to 275 million miles. By 1974, to 54,000 miles. By 1983, to a trillionth the diameter of a proton. And now, to nothing at all. So you can see that in a space of, I don't know, maybe under 40 years, it's actually changed from a huge something massive to something so small it's nothing at all. That's called a singularity. It says here, on creating something from nothing, it says the observable universe could have evolved from an infinitesimal region. It's then tempting to go one step further and speculate that the entire universe evolved from literally nothing. Now, the Big Bang theory is opposed to the second law of thermodynamics. That's the second most important law in physics. Let's look at the second law of thermodynamics. If you tossed a pile of bricks off the back of a lorry, would you expect the pile of bricks to look like the one on the left or the one on the right? I think you'd agree with me that disorder is more probable. Well, according to the second law of thermodynamics, we have to deal with something called entropy, which means that everything basically goes downhill. Here's an attractive young lady at the age of 20, and here's the same lady at the age of 90. And here's the same lady at 3,000. You notice she didn't get better, she got worse. And that's because of the second law of thermodynamics. It's because of entropy. That's why a hot cup of coffee cools down, the sun is cooling down, the earth is slowing down, our metabolic rate slows as we grow older, and a high-energy system will always decay to a low-energy system. So evolution, if it were true, would reverse this invariable rule which we see around us wherever we look. Conclusion based on the second law of thermodynamics is simply that evolution is impossible. Now, evolutionists assume that by adding energy to an open system, this will simply overcome the second law of thermodynamics. However, God doesn't regard our universe as an open system. In fact, he regards it as a closed system. There are actually 11, there's height, width, and depth, and then there's time, and various other things as well. And God lives outside time completely. So as far as God is concerned, this universe is a closed system. Now, if you add energy, the evolutionists claim that adding energy will organize the system. However, our observations are that adding energy is destructive. When we add energy to something, it's very destructive. Now, for example, in the Second World War, there were atomic bombs added to Hiroshima and Nagasaki, and that's the closest we can get to, perhaps, it's nothing like the Big Bang, but I mean, that's the closest atomic explosion that this world has ever seen. But I'll tell you one thing, in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, it didn't organize anything. It just actually flattened both cities completely. Now, systems can't get more complex by evolution or a Big Bang. They simply can't. According to the second law of thermodynamics, which talks about entropy, systems can't get more complex by evolution. You see, the evolutionists like to say everything will get more involved, more complex, and better, but actually that's not what the second law of thermodynamics has to say. Now we're going to look at the law of conservation of angular momentum. And this proves that the Big Bang theory really is incorrect. Let's look at the law of conservation of angular momentum. I want you to look at that spinning object at the center of the slide there and imagine that all those the balls spinning off it have spun off it and are all spinning in the same direction. Of course they are, and that's what you'd expect, and that's to do with the law of conservation of angular momentum. If you look carefully, you can see little tiny moons or little tiny balls around the smaller balls that have spun off the big one. And they would be like the moons going around the planets. They're also rotating in the same direction. So the basic law is that everything spins in the same direction. If everything's going clockwise, then everything would go clockwise. Now let's make it simple so we can all understand what we're talking about. Here's some children playing on a merry-go-round, and some friends come along and start pushing it, first at 30 miles an hour, and then the children get worried because it's going even faster and faster, and then they fly off because it's going so fast the centrifugal force causes them to lose their grip and they fly off. But the point is that they're all spinning in the same direction, and that's because of the law of conservation of angular momentum. Maybe they'll even hit a tree. Now, the conservation of angular momentum is absolutely fixed, and it can't be changed. And this is what Dr. Reeves says in his book, The Origin of the Solar System. This angular momentum would have caused the Sun to spin very rapidly. Actually, our Sun spins very slowly, while the planets move very rapidly around the Sun. In fact, although the Sun has over 99% of the mass of the solar system, it only has 2% of the angular momentum. This pattern is directly opposite to the pattern predicted by the nebula hypothesis. And then we look at Dr. Stuart Ross, who has this to say: the ultimate origin of the solar system's angular momentum remains obscure. I would agree with that. It's very obscure. In fact, if you look at the various, if you look at the planets up in the heavens, you'll find that Venus, Uranus, and Pluto, probably Pluto, rotate backwards from the other six planets. They rotate in a different direction. And that's not what they're supposed to do, not according to the law of conservation of linear momentum. It says, and if we look at the actual moons surrounding these planets, six of the 63 moons rotate backwards. Jupiter, Saturn, and Neptune have moons orbiting in both directions. Now, that really is very, very complicated for evolutionists to explain, because it really goes completely against the law of conservation of linear momentum. So my theory is that this never actually happened. There never was a Big Bang. Now we're going to look at the law of biogenesis. The law of biogenesis simply says that life cannot evolve spontaneously in the primordial slime. Life can't evolve from non-life forms. You can't get a crocodile evolving from a rock. You wouldn't expect that to happen in your garden, and nor would I. According to evolution, life arose by chance in the primordial slime 3 billion years ago. Well, that's not what the law of biogenesis says is supposed to happen. The law of biogenesis is quite clear that life does not arise from non-life forms. Now, the evolutionists, and particularly Darwin, like to talk about simple life forms, which also got more complicated as evolution progressed. And I'd like to make the point quite clearly right now that there are no simple life forms, and I'll show you some pictures. But first we're going to discuss DNA, which is the computer medium on which our bodies are constructed. Very, very complicated amino acids. It can be calculated mathematically using switching theory that the chance of one DNA molecule occurring randomly is one chance in 10 with 53 noughts after it. Now that is a huge, huge number, and all scientists say that anything with a chance greater than one chance in 10 with 50 noughts after it is impossible. So there we are, mathematically, it's impossible that DNA arose by chance in the primordial slime. Now look at this picture. You see, Darwin didn't have an electron microscope, but of course we do. This is a picture of a nerve ending. That's a picture of a nerve ending. And let me tell you, that is not simple. We know a little about what goes on inside a nerve in order to conduct electrical impulses along the nerve. And let me tell you, it is really, really complicated. Here is the electron microscope picture of a human brain cell. They're not simple, Mr. Darwin. They're not at all simple. They're really, really complicated. Here are human blood cells which carry oxygen around our bodies, and they are really complicated. They carry oxygen to our, all the cells in our bodies, and they are really complicated inside. But this is what Darwin had to say. From so simple a beginning, endless forms, most beautiful and wonderful, have been and are being evolved. Well, let me tell you, Mr. Darwin, I don't think you're correct on this point, because there are no simple life forms that I know about. They're all really, really complicated. Now, let's now look at natural selection as a mechanism to change from one species to another. I told you earlier, nobody's actually seen one species change into another. They like to talk about it, but nobody's actually seen one. Well, let's talk about whether this could actually be the case. Could natural selection be the mechanism to change from one species to another? Well, let's imagine a zebra on the left there, and let's decide that that particular zebra wants to learn to fly. So what's he going to do is he's going to grow some wing buds, presumably on his back. Now, zebras a lot of them live in Africa, and they have predators, particularly lions. And lions, what they tend to do is they hunt in packs, and they kill off and eat the zebras that are slow, or old, or young, or impeded by illness or anything else, such as lumps on its back. So if this particular zebra was carrying around lumps on its back, and I can't show you one because no one's ever observed one, but anyway, supposing that lion was chasing a slow zebra with lumps on its back, slow zebra would be caught off, would be picked off first, not last, which makes natural selection very suspect. But that's not what Charles Darwin has to say. He says old forms have been supplanted by new and improved forms of life. Well, I don't know where he got that information from, because it's simply not correct. Natural selection was not going to work in the natural environment. Now, there are no transitional life forms in the fossil record or in everyday life. If evolution happens very slowly, as taught by evolutionists, then we should see lots and lots of evidence of transitional life forms, not only in the fossil record, but also in day-to-day life. There's actually no evidence that I'm convinced of in the fossil record. You can read a lot about it in the scientific journals, but they talk about transitional life forms, but I can't convince myself that there are any. And also, if evolution happens slowly, as taught by evolutionists, we should see it happening all the time. We shouldn't have to go to the Galapagos Islands to watch evolution. We should actually see it in our own gardens. We should see it in our own homes. We should see our pets changing into ducks. We should see it all the time. In fact, most animals should be changing into other animals if evolution was true. The Bible says that each species was created each according to its kind, and science is actually the study of observable fact. And what we actually see is different kind or species of birds, animals and fish. We do not see animals changing into birds or anything else like that. Now, the evolutionists propose that the mechanism of improvement of the gene pool in a species is by gene mutation. You see, we're all designed according to our DNA. That's our computer codes in all of our cells. And the evolutionists say that if you can change the DNA,